Okay, so thank you. The general idea that in the same way that toposes are some kinds of generalized topological space, sister algebra are also objects that we want to think of as generalized topological space, so generalized locally compact space. And there is quite a long list of examples of geometric objects that can generate either a topos or a sister algebra. So for example, you have foliation, you have dynamical system, graph, certain finite automaton, and so on. And it's so quite natural idea to try to understand if there is somehow a general procedure to go from topos theory to operator algebra or the other direction. And so the first way to answer this question is to notice that both are closely related to topological groupoid. So I won't use that aspect concretely in my talk, but it somehow told us that the easy direction is to go from a topos to a sister algebra, to try to attach a sister algebra to a topos, and that's what I'm going to explain today, how we can do that, why the other direction is at least very difficult and more probably completely impossible without additional structure on the algebra. So let's just me explain a bit what I'm talking about. So okay, a sister algebra is just a Banach algebra with an antilinear involution which satisfies those axioms, so the involution will be noted by star. And the typical example are the algebra of bounded operator over Hilbert space. That's why they are called operator algebra. So in this case, the adjunction would be, for the star operation will just be the adjunction of operator. And of course, you have the example of commutative algebra. So algebra of the form C0 of X for X locally compact Hausdorff topological space. And C0 of X is for the algebra of continuous function with complex value, which tend to zero at infinity. So in this case, the star will be the complex conjugation. So, and it's a very classical result that I guess you all know that all commutative sister algebra are of this form. And if you define morphism correctly, then you have an equivalence of category between locally compact topological space, Hausdorff topological space, and commutative sister algebra. So let me give a first baby example of non-commutative algebra, which is not very interesting in itself, but which will be helpful to us near the end of the talk. So we will start from a topological space, and we will assume that it admits a finite covering by open subset, which are all locally compact and Hausdorff, but X might not be Hausdorff itself. So for example, the typical thing I have in mind is you start from a topological space X. So for example, the interval 1 minus 1, so it's compact in this case, but with a double point at the origin. So in this case, you have X, which is equal to U1 union U2, where they are both isomorphic to the closed interval. But their intersection is the interval minus the origin. So you have two origins. So in this case, you can associate a sister algebra to this covering. So basically, you construct some kind of matrix algebra. So it has as many rows as the number of open subsets you're using. And the coefficients are given by function of C0 of the intersection, in C0 of the intersection of the corresponding open subset. And if you look closely to that, you will see that matrix multiplication is well-defined for this. And this forms an algebra. So you can define the involution by taking both complex conjugation and exchanging row and column. And it appears that there is a uniquely defined norm that makes this into a sister algebra. And you can do something similar if the cover is infinite, but you need to do a bit more analysis as the matrix product of infinite matrix won't be defined in general. So, and something you can say that if X was actually Hausdorff itself, then this algebra is Morita equivalent to C0 of X. I will define what Morita equivalence means for sister algebra a bit later, but it's very close to Morita equivalence of rings. So for example, in this case, if you do this construction, you will get a function from the interval to 2 by 2 matrices, such that off-diagonal coefficient vanish at 0. So if you specialize at any point, you will get 2 by 2 matrices, which are Morita equivalent to C. So you basically get 1 point for each non-zero element of this interval. But if you localize at 0, you get C square, which is correspond to the 2-point space. So you see, you can see into the algebra the double point at the origin. So this is not a very interesting example from the point of view of non-commutative geometry, but it can show how a non-commutative algebra can somehow handle spaces that are not themselves Hausdorff. So I will give a more interesting example. If you take basically any group, discrete group acting on the locally compact Hausdorff topological space, then there is a construction of a cross-product algebra. So it's generated by a function, so by element of C0 of X, and by formal element corresponding to the element of the group, which satisfy a classical algebraic relation. So the generator from the group multiply as in the group algebra, and the and you can exchange size side between function and generator from the group using the action from the group of the space. And so you have, again, you can put a norm on this. You can generate a sister algebra. Well, actually, you don't have a unique norm, but you can choose one and generate a sister algebra. And what happened is that if the action of G is free and proper, then this algebra is actually Morita equivalent to the algebra of function on the quotient. So it's the same idea that if the quotient by the action of the group went well, then you actually don't get anything more if you see the sister algebra up to Morita equivalence. But in most situations, the cross product will contain a lot more information than just the algebra over the quotient, which in general will be trivial.
For example, if X is a point,
then you will get the group algebra.
The group algebra, but with some kind of L2 or L1 group algebra versions of the
group? So if the group, well, you will get the group C star algebra.
The group C star algebra. Yeah. What's the norm in this case?
So you have two choices. Either you can take a universal norm, which is the infimum of all norms that make supremum of all norms of coming from all representation. Or you can take the norm coming from the left regular representation on L2. That's two different choices in general. And you have sometimes intermediate choice as well. So to this situation of a group acting on a topological space, you can also associate a topos, of course. So it's a topos of equivariant shift that has been introduced in the case of the scaling side this morning. And so it corresponds to the quotient of the topos by the action of the group in the two category of toposes. And it also appears that this topos of equivariant shift will be equivalent to the topos of shift on the quotient, basically if the action is free and proper. So we have the same situation. If the topos that we construct this way is actually the topos of shift over the quotient, then the algebra is the Morita equivalent to the algebra of shift over the quotient. So this somehow suggests that it should be possible to define the algebra up to Morita equivalence directly from the topos. And so, as I said, that's what we are trying to do. So the first point for this construction is that using internal logic of toposes, we have a very good notion of continuous field of Hilbert space and sister algebra and Banach space over a topos. So we call them continuous field because that's a historical terminology, but morally there are things that we would like to call field of Hilbert space, sheaf of Hilbert space and sheaf of sister algebra and sheaf of Banach space. And concretely, they are defined just as the Hilbert space, sister algebra, and Banach space object of the internal logic. So I will say explicitly what it means in a minute. Okay. So as the internal logic of a topos, as André Joyal explained yesterday, is in general intuitionistic logic, we need to be a bit more careful on what we call the Hilbert space, because, I mean, if you don't have the law of exclusion middle, all the definition you know of real number basically give all different objects. So there is a lot of things that need to be made precise. So first thing is that a complex number or real number, when they are used as scalar, the ring of scalar, because all these are vector space, real vector space in general. So we use what we call the continuous real number and continuous complex number, so also called Dedekind real number. And they correspond to two-sided Dedekind cuts. So we define a real number as a two-sided Dedekind cuts. But there is a subtlety that norms cannot take value in continuous real number because they have this little problem that they don't satisfy the supremum property, like a bounded subset of continuous real number does not always have a supremum, and norms tend to be defined as supremum in general. So if we force our norm to take value in continuous numbers, then we lose a lot of examples. For example, the algebra of bounded operator of a Hilbert space won't be a Banach algebra with a restrictive definition like this. So we take what we call the upper semi-continuous real number, which are upper Dedekind cuts, so one-sided Dedekind cuts. And those have very poor algebraic property. but they have all supremums, so we can define norm with value in this, and they contain the continuous real number, so all axiom of norm can be defined without problem. And the last point we need to make precise is what completeness means, because Hilbert space, Banner space, and sister algebra need to be complete. So we use the definition by Cauchy filter, because Cauchy sequence doesn't work really very well without a countable or dependent axiom of choice. And I forgot to mention, it's written that for Hilbert space, the norms are continuous because they come from a bilinear form, and to write down bilinearity, we need to take value in continuous complex number. So when you define everything like this and you look at what happened for the topos of Sheaf over a topological space, you get the previously known notion, which are, well, I think they are due to Fell, but I'm not exactly sure, of a continuous field of Hilbert space and what we call semi-continuous field of sister algebra and Banner space. So now we can make, for example, those Hilbert space objects into a category. So morphism between them will be globally bounded operator. So what does that mean? So operator are linear map which admit an adjoint, because without the law of x to the middle, it's not automatically true that any bounded linear map between Hilbert space have an adjoint. And globally bounded just means that so they are internally bounded operator, but the norm is bounded by an external constant, so a globally defined constant. So if we have Sheaf of Hilbert space over a topological space, this means what we think it is, that the norm is globally bounded on all the space and not just locally bounded, which would be the meaning of internally bounded. And so the result is that this category of Hilbert space and globally bounded operator between them is what we call a C-star category. So it's a several object generalization of a C-star algebra, and roughly what it means is that if you take one of those Hilbert space and look at its algebra fundamorphism, it is actually a C-star algebra.
Considered externally.
So this produces a first way to take a topos and associate a whole bunch of C-star algebra, which is a good starting point, but it's not exactly what we want. So there is two problems. The first is that all those algebra that we produce are not Morita equivalents or not even related to each other, well, not as precisely as we would want. And the other is that if we look at all the examples we had of situation where we actually want to attach a C-star algebra to a topos, they don't give the good sister algebras. They give algebras that are a bit too big. Generally, the good sister algebra appears as a certain subalgebra of those, but there is apparently no nice way to recognize them. So, and the reason we get big algebra is actually very natural to understand. So if you look at the algebra of all operators of a Hilbert space of infinite dimension, then this is an extremely complicated sister algebra, which is not Morita equivalent to the complex number. It works if you are on a finite dimensional Hilbert space, you'll get something Morita equivalent to complex number. But in the infinite dimensional case, what you want to do is to look at the algebra of compact operator, which are those operators which can be approximated by finite rank operator. And so this is roughly why we get way too much element in our algebra, because we are looking at arbitrary operator on Hilbert space that can be infinite dimensional. So I will make a small parenthesis. So today I'm concerned about the what I call the topological case, because sister algebra corresponds to locally compact topological space. But there is a completely parallel story which could make another talk and which I will sum up in about 1 minute. So there is also the theory of von Neumann algebra, which are specific sister algebra which correspond to measurable space. So commutative von Neumann algebra is something of the form L infinity of x mu for some measured space and mu measure, which is the algebra of almost every bounded function with the subnorm, with the essential subnorm. And the point is that B of H is a von Neumann algebra, and it's a good von Neumann algebra. It's Morita, in the sense of von Neumann algebra, it's Morita equivalent to C. So in this case, B of H is a good choice. So that's why the story works better in the measurable case. So if we take a Boolean toposes, then the C-star category we get by looking at Hilbert space over the topos is what we call the monotone complete C-star category. And so it's almost the same as a von Neumann category, which are called W-star category. And under a really reasonable assumption of existence of local measure over this Boolean topos, then we actually get a W-star category. So we get von Neumann algebra this way. So, and now the point is that any topos admit a covering by Boolean toposes. And if we choose a covering by a Boolean topos such that the map is injective, we can actually think as those Hilbert space over this Boolean cover as measurable field of Hilbert space over the topos. And this is a way that to attach from Neuman algebra to any topos by choosing a Boolean covering, which corresponds morally to some sort of generalized measure class. And we get an algebra which can be thought of some kind of generalized algebra of measurable function over the topos. So this approach, this measure theoretic approach, can be applied very to basically any topos, but it loses all the information of topological nature. So it's probably interesting for all the topos that come from algebraic geometry, so etal topos or the scaling sites, and also to topos that are classifying topos for theories that are algebraic. I don't mean in the concrete sense, but that are algebraic in nature. Because those topos have very poor algebraic topology, and they behave like, for example, Zariski spectrum, and we cannot expect to have anything interesting by looking at continuous function on them with value in complex number. So let me come back to the topological space. So in this situation, the idea is that we want to restrict to topos that have nice topological properties that are analogous to locally compact Hausdorff topological space. So let's, for a minute, look at locally compact Hausdorff topological space. So let's call it X, and assume we have a Hilbert space over X, which is denoted by H. So we can look at gamma of H, the set of global section of H. So H is a sheave. It's a sheave endowed with a structure of an Hilbert space internally. And so it obviously comes with a structure of a C of X module, where C of X is the algebra of all complex valued function on X. So, but because H is a Hilbert space object, it also has a scalar product that can externally, well, on global section, can be seen as a pairing. If you take two global sections of gamma of H, then you can compute their scalar product, and it's going to be a complex valued continuous function on your space. So you get some sort of scalar product with value on C of X. And then you can consider the space gamma zero of H of sections such that the norm, so the scalar product with themselves, is actually in C0, so goes to zero at infinity. And this is what we call a right Hilbert C0 of X module, so I will write explicitly what it means. So because C0 of X is commutative, there is no real difference between right and left module, but I will write a definition that works for non-commutative algebra too, so that's why I'm precising that it's a right Hilbert module. So first, it's a right C0 of X module. So it has this scalar product which takes value in C0 of X. You can check that if you have two elements in gamma zero, then because of Cauchy-Schwarz, the scalar product is also C0. So we have those algebraic axioms. So it's linear in the second variable, and I actually mean linear additively too. And if you permute the variable, then it's you apply the star operation. So it will be somehow antilinear in the first variable. And so when you have the first three axioms, then this actually defines the norms on this space, and we ask it is complete for this norm.
And by the norm here, you really mean the supremum over all the points of X?
Yeah. It's a norm in the algebra, so it's a subnorm.
So it's not a local norm?
No, this is external. I was thinking about the norm of the C-star algebra.
And that's why you choose to C0 to have, because in C0 it goes to zero, not infinity,
yeah.
Right?
So the reason, so it will work if I have if I choose to take all bounded function, for example. But for what I will state in 1 second, it's important to have C0. So the point is that we have an equivalence of category between the category of Hilbert space over X and of Hilbert C0 of X module. Well, if we have chosen to take bounded functions, then we'll have get Hilbert's, a continuous field of Hilbert space over the Stone-Schwarz compactification of the space. So, okay, this is actually the kind of result, the way we want to attach a C-star algebra to a topos. We want a theorem of this form. And so that's the theorem I'm going to talk about today. So I will state it first and then explain what it means. So it's what I call the topos theoretic Grothendieck theorem. So we start with a topos that satisfies a certain list of conditions that I'm going to explain in a few minutes. So it has to be separated, it has to be locally decidable, and its localic reflection has to be locally compact. Then we actually have a sister algebra that will denote C0 of T, such that the category of Hilbert space over T is equivalent to the category of Hilbert C0 of T module. So those Hilbert space with a scalar product taking value in C0 of T. And so this C0 of T is well defined up to Morita equivalence, up to unique Morita equivalence. So I still haven't defined what's Morita equivalence for sister algebra, but now I can do it. Two sister algebra are Morita equivalent if their category of Hilbert module are equivalent. And there is an analogous theory as for theory of ring. We can describe a Morita equivalence as a certain bimodule and so on. And so this last statement is completely tautological because I've described the category of Hilbert module over the algebra, so it's completely useless to write it down actually. So this is the theorem I want to talk about today. So it's produced a nice way to get a sister algebra from from certain topos satisfying nice topological condition. So I'm going to explain this condition, but first I want to mention that there is also a version with coefficient. So we can also take C to be a sister algebra over T, so a sister algebra is the internal logic. And then we can construct an ordinary, so classical sister algebra in set C submajoract with T, such that the category of Hilbert C module over T is equivalent to the category of Hilbert C cross T module.
But this C cross T is an actual?
Yeah, it's a real, concrete, external sister algebra, yeah. And it's also unique up to unique Morita equivalence for the exact same reason. But I will focus on the version without coefficient because the proof is basically the same whether you use coefficient or not. So let me explain what those conditions separated locally decidable mean. So we'll start with locally decidable. So an object of a topos is said to be decidable if we have internally that for all x, y in x, we have x equal y or x not equal to y, which is a form of law of excluded middle, which of course does not hold in an arbitrary topos. So externally, it means that the sheave or the object x times x can be decomposed into a coproduct of two sub-sheave or sub-object, one which is the diagonal and one which is, something else, a complement of the diagonal. So for example, if you are over a locally connected topological space, then this decidability condition corresponds to the analytic continuation property. So for example, the sheaf of holomorphic function on some RC over some complex manifold is decidable. So decidable objects are important because that's one where you can actually count the element or taking sum index over them. The point is that if you are not even able to tell if given two elements they are equal or different, then it's completely impossible to count the element or to take a sum index by the element. So for example, if you want to define the Hilbert space L2 of X for some set or some object of the topos X, you need X to be decidable. So either because you will define it as a set of square summable sequence, and to define summable, you need the set to be decidable, or even more clearly, L2 of X is the space which has one generator for each element of X, and those generator satisfy this condition that their scalar product is equal to one if they are equal, and zero otherwise. And in order that this makes sense, you need the set to be decidable. That's exactly what it says. So we say that a topos is locally decidable if he has enough decidable objects, so if every object can be covered by a decidable object. So locally topos, so for example, all topos of sheave over a topological space are automatically decidable. All étendues, so toposes of equivariant sheave over étale groupoid, are also locally decidable. And if we want counterexamples, then pre-sheave topos are most of the time not locally decidable. So they are locally decidable exactly if all the arrows of the corresponding category are epimorphism. So this is a condition that we like from the point of view of non-commutative geometry, because most of the time when we want to attach sister algebra to a semigroup or to category, we want it to be left cancellative, which is exactly what this condition of epimorphism means. Yeah. And yeah, also, I actually don't know any example of a topos which is not locally decidable and which has Hilbert space that don't come from its locally decidable part. So I actually think that this construction of looking at Hilbert space over a topos is only interesting for locally decidable topos. But I haven't been able to prove it. I just have observed it on all examples. So this was for the locally decidable part. So it's a really weak condition that is absolutely not the most important in the theorem. The important condition is separated. So it's a condition which is due to Mordijk and Fermolin. So a geometric morphism between two topos is said to be proper if internally in T. So André Joyal explained yesterday that when you have a geometric morphism, you can think of it as a topos in the internal logic of T, which is morally the idea that you want to work fiber-wise. So you want to work with E fiber by fiber. And so we say that a morphism is proper if this internal topos is compact, where compact means the locally reflection is compact, and so it's just the usual finite covering condition. So it's basically we are saying that something is proper if it's fiber-wise compact, but in a locally uniform way, and for topological space, it's completely equivalent to the usual definition of a proper map. And so we say that a topos is separated if its diagonal map is proper, which is analogous to the usual definition that something is separated if the diagonal map is closed, with the exception that for toposes, the diagonal doesn't have to be an inclusion, so proper and compact and closed became different, and that's why we are using proper, which is a better condition, better behaved. So for topological space, this is almost the same as the ordinary Hausdorff condition. It's slightly stronger. The reason why it's different is because the product of toposes is not exactly the product of topological space. But for example, if you restrict to locally compact space, then it's exactly the same, and all the T3, T4, and other Hausdorff condition imply this topos-theoretic separated condition. But so for topological space, it's a very reasonable condition, but for general topos, it's an extremely restrictive condition. So for the topos of G set, so set endowed with an action of G, the topos is separated if and only if the group is finite. And if you consider a pro-discrete topological group, then it means the group is compact. So it's very restrictive. And for general groupoids, they correspond to the notion of a proper groupoid, so a groupoid whose action map is proper. So separated is a very restrictive condition, and I will explain at the end of the talk how we can apply the theorem to non-separated topos in an interesting way. Okay, so let's come back to our theorem. So I've told you what separated and locally decidable mean, and locally reflection is locally compact is, I didn't really see. So the locally reflection is just the, so you have the, you have the inclusion of the category of local into the category of topos, and it has a left adjoint. Wait, let me write it. So you have OM TL, which is isomorphic to the morphism from the locally reflection of T to L, where T is a topos and L is a local. And for example, if you are considering a topos attached to a dynamical system, as I mentioned in the beginning, then this locally reflection is the coarse topological quotient, that you're quotienting the space by the action of the group as a topological space. So this last condition is also very weak because for most interesting example, the locally reflection will be actually simpler than a lot simpler than the space we are starting from. So it's called a Grothendieck theorem because the Grothendieck theorem is something that basically says the same thing for groupoid instead of for topological groupoid instead of toposes. So for proper groupoid, we have an equivalence of category between Hilbert module over the reduced sister algebra of the groupoid and a continuous field of Hilbert space over the groupoid endowed with an action of the for equivariant continuous field of Hilbert space over the groupoid. So the point here is that because those two theorems exist both for groupoid and for topos, we know that when they both apply, they both give the same result because they are, well, up to Morita equivalence, we have the same category of Hilbert module over the algebra. So this is what told us that this this algebra C0 of T is the correct algebra to attach to the topos in all examples that we know. So, there is also a constructive version of the topos theoretic version. So it's basically the same, we just need to add some adjective here and there. So separated stays the same. Locally decidable, well, we could keep the same, but we can actually weaken the condition and only say that the category is generated by decidable objects, which is equivalent if we have classical logic, but it's weaker in constructive logic. It has a site of definition.
Of coordinates?
Yeah. C0T is an external or an internal?
External. Okay. External. The actual thing that we really need to change is we need to add one condition of that the locality reflection is completely regular, which means that there is an off continuous function of it. So in classical mathematics, it's a consequence of separated and locally compact by the reason lemma, but constructively, it doesn't work very well. And there is another thing that we need to change is that C0 of T cannot exactly be constructive as a C-star algebra. We actually get it as a C-star category. So we can turn it into a C-star algebra 90% of the time, for example, as soon as the base topos is itself locally decidable. But in general, it might be a small problem. So the point of having a constructive version, of course, is to have a relative version of the theorem. So now if I have a geometric morphism like this, which internally satisfy the condition of the theorem, then I can relate Hilbert module over T to Hilbert C module over E for some C-star algebra internal to E. So the reason why I was really interested in this constructive version, it's actually how I was planning to prove the theorem first by using this some kind of dévisage with an intermediate topos and proving it first for this morphism and then for this morphism in a way that I will explain in a minute. But actually, in the final proof, I didn't need to do that, so we could prove the classical theorem directly. So I'll explain roughly how the proof works, because it's actually really helpful to understand what is this algebra C0 of T. So the first part is I have proved an abstract characterization of C-star category, which are of the form a category of Hilbert module over C-star algebra. So this characterization is analogous to the fact that an abelian category is a category of module over some ring if it has a projective generator of finite type, and if it's co-complete. So basically, if you have an abelian category and an object inside it, you get a functor by taking om from this object to another object, from your category to the category of module over the ring of endomorphism of the object. And if you assume that this object is a projective generator of finite type, then you get an equivalence of category, I think. I actually haven't checked that this is true, but it sounds like an easy result. So I've proved the C-star categorical version only. So in order to have something similar for C-star category, there is two difficult steps. The first is that we need a notion of co-completeness, which is adapted to C-star category. Because, well, I think no C-star category can be co-complete in the ordinary categorical sense. Anyway, the category of Hilbert module over C-star algebra are not. But it's actually possible to work something out. It's not really a nice, convenient notion, but it's enough to prove a theorem of this kind. And then we can define an abstract notion of compact operators. So compact operators are supposed to be those which are approximable by a finite rank operator. And it appears that the compactness can be characterized with some kind of categorical property related to this notion of complexness. And we can define an abstract notion of compact operator in a co-complete C-star category. And then it's possible to formulate an abstract characterization similar to this as So a C-star category will be a category of Hilbert module over something if it's co-complete, if it has sufficiently many compact operators, and if it has a generator. And the proof of the theorem is then roughly the same as for the abelian category case. So that's the first step. The second step is that it's not really hard. We can prove that for any topos, the category of Hilbert space over G satisfies this C-star categorical co-completeness condition. Yeah, I not make the difference between co-complete and complete, because in a C-star category, you have this adjunction that reverses the direction of morphism, so I actually have no reason to think that complete is different from co-complete, but technically it's a more of a co-completeness condition. So we can prove that those categories of Hilbert space over G are co-complete in this sense, and that so operators which are internally compact operator and whose norm tend to zero at infinity, so it means on the localic reflection. If you have a continuous family of operators, its norm is actually a function on the localic reflection. And if it tends to zero at infinity, then those operators are compact in the sense of the above characterization. So then there is the difficult step, which if I have time, I will say more about it. So it's a purely topos theoretical thing. We need a constructive proof that if we have a topos which is separated, locally decidable, and hyperconnected — hyperconnected means the localic reflection is trivial, reduced to a point — then the topos actually admit a generating family of objects which are finite and decidable. So finite and decidable for the internal logic. So those are exactly objects which are internally isomorphic to something of the form 1, 2, etc., 2n. So this is a purely topos theoretic result, which is in a paper that I put on archive a few months ago. And actually, at this point, the end of the proof is relatively easy. So one can use this constructive result about separated, locally decidable, and hyperconnected topos. So let's come back to this diagram. So we have T. We have its localic reflection. And so within this topos, this one is separated, hyperconnected, and locally decidable. So we can apply the third point internally, and we get objects which are somehow finite in this topos relatively to this one. And finite objects are all we need to construct a finite rank operator, which are in particular compact operator. And so it's at this point, it's relatively easy to, by using some partition function with compact support on this space, to actually construct explicitly N of compact operator in the category of Hilbert space. And we can also construct a generator. And so this last step is actually relatively easy, just showing that everything works together well. So what this proof told us is that this algebra C0 of T is basically just the algebra of compact operator over some Hilbert space over the topos, which is big enough, where big enough means it's a generator in the sense that I had to construct in the first point. And by compact operator, I mean in the abstract sense, so operators which are internally compact and whose norm tend to zero at infinity.
This is an external.
Yeah. C0 of T is an external. So it's the algebra of global section of external endomorphism, which internally are compact and whose norm tend to zero at infinity.
Is it true that there is an Hilbert space such that this is isomorphic to the
yeah.
of H for some?
Yeah, that's the theorem.
You mean a global Hilbert space? Or what do you mean?
Well, yeah, there's
Hilbert space. So it's a C-star. It's not a.
No, there is
a single Hilbert space.
There is one Hilbert space over the topos, such that C0 of T is the algebra of compact operator of this Hilbert space. But it's not, yeah, it's not a classical Hilbert space.
Yeah, but these are C-star algebra. I'm not an expert of C-star algebra. I assume that they are very special, no?
The C0 of T? Yeah, algebras that arise from separated toposes are of a very specific form. What I can say is that they are what we call type 1 algebra. I don't know if they we fall in a more restrictive class, but then I will explain how to use this for non-separated topos, and we can go out of this very specific situation.
But also the C-star K-tubules are presumably symmetric monoidal K-tubules, for example.
Yes. Yes, we also... they should also have this. It's actually very important if we want to try to reconstruct the topos from this C-star algebra. We need this monoidal structure, but I will not talk about it today. So we are now to the. So if I have time, I will come back to the third purely topos theoretical result at the end. So I want to explain how we can generalize to non-separated toposes. So this finiteness result really require separation to work. So there is no way to go around it. In fact, if you take basically any example of topos which is not separated, then you can show that there is basically no compact operator of this form in almost every example you can think of. So we really need this separation condition to have any hope to have this Grothendieck theorem working. So, but there is something we can do if the topos is locally of the form of the theorem. So by locally, I mean that we have an object which I would prefer to assume that it is decidable and inhabited, meaning that it has a local section everywhere. Well, because otherwise you could take the empty object, of course. Such that this the slice topos T over X, so the etale space of X, satisfies the hypothesis of the theorem. So maybe, so yeah, by T over X, I just mean the category of objects with an arrow to X, with Y in T, so this is in T. So it's a topos, and geometrically, it's the etale space of the sheaf X. So if T is a topological space, X is a sheaf, then this is the category of sheaf over the etale space of the sheaf. So it's a space which is locally isomorphic to the base space. So that's why we call this locally of the form of the theorem. And so this this situation includes basically all the examples I know of topos where it seems interesting to try to construct a sister algebra. I cannot prove this, of course, but all the examples I know are of this form. And in this case, when we can actually construct a sister algebra attached to a topos which is only locally of this form, basically by using a generalization of the matrix trick I talked about in the second slide. So we had a situation where we had a space which was not itself separated and locally compact, but which was locally separated and locally compact, and we were able to construct a sister algebra forming some sort of matrix, and up to Morita equivalence, it was exactly what we wanted to do. So that's exactly what we are going to do here. So we have our topos, which is, so we have an object X, which as I said, I prefer to assume it's decidable. We assume that T over X satisfies our theorem. So then we pick a Hilbert space in T over X, so we can think of it as a family of Hilbert space HX indexed by X internally in T, because, well, a Hilbert space over a set is just a family of Hilbert space. And so we take a IH, which is a generator of the Hilbert space of T over X, which is big enough. So we can actually assume that it is this family is constant in X, so it's actually an Hilbert space in T that we have pulled back to T over X if one wants. It's not really important. So if we look at an endomorphism of the direct sum, so we can construct an Hilbert space which is the derived direct sum, the orthogonal sum of all this HX, so it's an Hilbert space in T. If I have an endomorphism of this thing, well, it's a map between two direct sums, so I can have a matrix decomposition. So, so let's say we have a H. Then by composing by the injection in the projection there, I have matrix elements, which are operator H from HX. And so this is something that live in this topos, the slice topos over X time X. It depends on two parameters in X, so it naturally lives in this topos. And I'm considering the algebra of such element, such that all this arrow from HX to HX prime are internally compact operator, and such that it's zero outside the compact subspace of these toposes. So I'm somehow looking at a matrix with compact support. And so it appears that this such element with compact support actually form an algebra that I can call C of T. So then I need to construct a norm on this, but that the classical theory of algebra of groupoids works exactly the same. I have several choices, either the maximal norm or the reduced norm, as we talked about for group earlier. And in both cases, I can take the completion is going to be a sister algebra. So I will get either a reduced or a maximal sister algebra exactly as we have for groupoid. So this produces a way to attach the sister algebra to any topos that is locally of this form, which works perfectly on all examples, but is not as nice as we could have hoped, because, for example, at first sight, it's not clear at all that this algebra is well-defined up to Morita equivalence. We need to prove it as a theorem. And, what I mean is that it will be better if we have a more universal characterization in the locally separated case. So I will say a word about the proof of the of this point at separated, locally decidable, hyperconnected topos is generated by finite objects, because it's the most important part of the proof, and it's really nice results, which I'm sure have other applications than considering Hilbert space and sister algebra of topos. So the proof goes into two steps. So let's say we have T, a topos, which is separated, locally decidable, and hyperconnected. So you actually don't need to know what all those conditions mean to understand the proof that's coming. So the first step is to solve the case where the topos has a point. So first, assume T as a point. So in this case, there is a very nice result of Ikemordike and Fermolin, which is basically a constructive version of Grothendieck-Galois theory, which say that then T is actually isomorphic to the category of set with, so I remember I need the proof to be constructive. A non-constructive proof of this would be very easy. Of set with an action of a locally group G. And G is actually the group of automorphism of the point. So the automorphism of the point in general locally group. So if we were in classical mathematics, then this would actually, we could actually prove that this topos has finite object as much as we want, because the group is compact, for locally compact group, sorry. And well, if you have a compact group acting on a set, then you can decompose the set into the disjoint union for its orbit, and the orbit for the action of a compact group are finite. So we would have all the finite objects that we want. There is a big problem with that, which is that because this is not a point set topological group, but a locally group, if the group does not satisfy a technical condition, which is called to be open, which is always satisfied in classical mathematics, then the orbit of a point actually might not exist. It's defined as a sublocal of the set on which it acts, and it might not be a set. So we cannot use the orbit to construct finite subobjects. Actually, if orbit exists, then we are in the case of an atomic topos, and it's completely trivial. But there is still something we can do. So if I have X decidable, so that's why I need the topos to be locally decidable, with an action of G, and if I take an element of the set, then because the group of the group is compact, I still know that the orbit, which is not a set but still makes sense, is contained in some finite set. I just cannot construct actually a set which is stable under G at first sight. And by exact same argument, I can also construct an F prime such that if I look at the action of G on F, this is included into some other finite set. And at this point, there is a really nice combinatorial argument. So it's still true that in constructive mathematics, if you have two compact local k and k prime such that k and k prime is empty, they are both compact, then k is empty or k prime is empty. That's something that is still true in constructive mathematics, and that's what saves us. Because basically, every time you have a point in f prime, then if you try to look at the set of pair of elements in G such that G times G prime times x is your element, it will always be empty. Because it will be G of x, so it will be in f. So those are finite sets into a decidable set, so they are decidable. We know if we when we have an element in f prime, it's in, if it's in f or not in f. So the product of the two compact thing is empty, so we know that one of them is empty. So either our element cannot be written as coming from an element of f, either it cannot be attained by an element coming from f. So in one case, we can eliminate it from f prime, and in the other case, we can actually remove an element in f. And in both cases, we can either reduce the side of f prime or the side of f up to the point where the two are going to be equal by induction. And when the two are equal, we actually have found a stable finite set. And that actually works. So this is the case where it has a point. So the general case works by what we call decent theory. So a topos, if it doesn't have a point, always has a point in some covering. All those hypotheses are stable by pulling back. So we are going to get finite objects in some covering, and then there is an involved decent argument that I'm not going to explain that allow to get finite objects in the base topos from those finite objects in the covering. So yes, I think that's all I had to say. So thank you for your attention.
May I ask, so concerning the topos theoretic properties, I'm not quite familiar with, but the notion of proper, so if you consider the case of coherent toposes and coherent morphisms, which is usually the case in algebraic geometry, yeah, what does proper mean?
I hope I'm not going to say something wrong, but I think they are always proper because coherence implies compactness property.
Okay, this okay. And then it seems, so this is strange relative to what you said, because if you take a usual scheme, for example, so or spectral space, then you try to look whether it's separated in the sense that you define. So you take the product of x and x in the sense of topos, so this is the same as product of spectral spaces, and
no,
then you have the diagonal, no?
No.
No?
Scheme are, well, any topos coming from a scheme, whether it's Zariski, et al., Linsnevich, or whatever you want, will, except for case of field, will never be separated in the sense I define. Basically, because the topological part will always be something like a Zariski space and which will never be separated itself. The topological part of the topos will always be a Zariski-like.
No, but I asked you before, the first question is for this. That
yeah.
I ask you whether a coherent morphism of coherent.
Yeah, but the diagonal of a coherent, the product of two coherent topos, as I don't think it's coherent, and the diagonal morphism won't be coherent. Well, something is going to go wrong at this point because coherent topos are not separated. Well, in general, there is some exception, of course. But, so.
But I think that the product of coherent topos is coherent, you mean? Okay, as far as I know, you can write down specific sites of definition and
yeah,
you can see
that.
Okay, so it's a diagonal which is not a coherent map then. So if the product is coherent, then it means the diagonal is not a coherent morphism. Anyway, the product of et al. Or Zariski topos does not relate to the product of scheme.
No, I'm not saying product of scheme, the product of just the underlying topological space. of the scheme. So you take the spectral space X, make it in, consider the corresponding topos of
yeah,
C. Then you have X cross X is the corresponding topos theoretic, corresponding topos theoretic product, I think. And I think the diagonal map is, and so the diagonal map is spectral, and so you get, there is a contradiction in the information you.
I don't understand what's wrong with what you say, but I can tell you it's wrong because if you take a topos which is separated in the sense I said, then it's a really very easy result that its localic reflection is separated. And those toposes coming from algebraic geometry, their localic reflection is never separated or only on the very specific case like a field.
For the localic reflection, it is a Hausdorff space?
Yeah, it, almost the same. It's slightly stronger than Hausdorff space. So I don't really, I mean, I'm not really an expert on coherent topos, so I'm not.
Because I need in some things, so maybe a coherent morphism of coherent topos is not proper then.
Maybe I was wrong on that, yeah. Okay. I don't know.
Then if you're wrong, if this, okay, then it explains my.
I'm not really familiar with coherent topos.
I think that's the case, actually. Yeah.
Okay, then thank you.
Then sorry, I said something wrong. I shouldn't have said it.
And so if I want to know about this, then it is the paper that you mentioned of Vermeulen and Moore.
What?
Which paper? Which reference do you have for this?
For the miserable theoretic case.
For this concepts of.
With the Boolean covering.
Then the
no, separation.
Oh, for separation, yeah, it's a paper of Mordijk and Vermeulen, and it's called Proper Map of Topos.
Okay, I remember this.
Yeah, you have everything in this. And it's also in Johnson's book, in Johnson's Sketches of an Elephant.
Ah, the elephant.
Yeah.
I just have one which is a relation with the previous talk. Because in the previous talk, we saw that for one topos, the notion of local compact was the same, I mean, from André, from the result of Joyal and Nostor, that it was the same thing as being exponentiable.
Yeah.
So, but of course, this didn't take into account separation. But so, I mean, this result would suggest that the correct domain for associating a sister algebra would be exponentiable, at least.
I mean, no, I don't think so.
You don't think so? I should have told you before asking my question, don't answer too fast.
No, yeah, sure. The problem is that locally compact already contain things that are not locally separated.
No, no, but I am saying that it should be part of the condition. Of course, there should be separation besides that.
Yeah.
But it seems very natural that the notion of being exponentiable should enter into the construction.
Oh, yeah, sure. Well, I mean, the topos that satisfy those hypotheses are exponentiable.
They are exponentiable. So
yeah.
Maybe you should try to push the construction to the largest possible class of exponentiable topos.
Yeah, maybe, but the thing is I really don't know how to go beyond this result.
No, but what I mean is that the fact that there is a concept behind which is exponentiability should
yeah.
be a guide.
Maybe, but... I really don't know. I mean... At some point, we need locally compact groupoid, in some sense.
No,
and locally compact really...
It's a very conceptual notion.
No, sure.
It tells you that you can, you know, so I mean, somehow it seems very natural.
Yeah, what I mean is that you cannot hope to attach a sister algebra to a non-locally compact topological group, I think.
Yeah, of course. But that's, okay.
And there are... If you don't put this locally separated assumption, then you will get locally non-locally compact group at some point, so...
I don't know how to associate a topos to a locally compact group, actually.
Well, if it's pro-discrete, then you can look at continuous action and say.
Yeah, but that is, then this is not the right thing. I mean, you know, what I have in mind is that locally compact groups don't really fit. So
yeah, no, that's the problem of this formalism, of course. So you lose a connected isotropy group.
Yes, and there is another thing which is quite important to know, which is that somehow you know, there is a richness in sister algebras which is not in topos. And that comes from the fact that there are sister algebras which are not anti-isomorphic to themselves, or even in the measure theory. And that says that they cannot come from something which is purely combinatorial.
Yeah.
Well, so actually, the two worlds cannot be the same.
Actually, all the cyst algebra that we get this way come with a real structure.
Sure.
So they are isomorphic to their dual.
So, I mean, in general, you cannot hope for an equivalence of categories. These are things which are...
Well, I have an objection to this. Using the version with coefficient, we can define groupoid algebra twisted by a cocycle.
Yeah, you can twist by a cocycle. So, but what I'm saying is that certainly you would need to twist by a cocycle.
Yeah.